We are at 104. I'm going to hit record just because we have 32 of you here joining us today for the third installation of Color Our Future conversation series. I think that I want to start sharing my screen. And as folks join in, please take a moment to introduce yourselves on the chat. That's where we're going to be capturing also questions for later on. And with that, let's see, Jeffrey, on which screen can you see right now?
I can see the first slide on the slide deck.
Perfect. Okay, so I am just gonna pass it on to you and let's get started.
Okay, well, welcome everyone. My name is Jeffrey Ann Wilder. I'm on the social science team at NCWIT, and as Johnny said, welcome to our third conversation around Black women and girls in tech. The conversation today focuses on Black women in the tech workforce. The previous two conversations we've had have been absolutely fantastic, and I have no doubt that today will not disappoint. So if we could move to the next slide, which I think has an overview of our hour. Johnny just gave us the welcome. I'm going to spend a little bit more time sharing with you all what this series is about and talking more about our wonderful esteemed panelists. At that point, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Catherine Ashcraft, who is going to lead our conversation today. And then we'll move into Q&A. What we've been noticing in the past two conversations that we have so much to talk about that once we near our hour, we don't, we haven't had a whole lot of time for our question and answer. So we are going to unofficially or officially end right at the hour. But if folks are able to stick around for an additional 10 to 15 minutes, you're more than welcome to, so we can ensure that we get through, I'm sure, the lots of questions and comments that folks will have as a result of today's conversation. And again, welcome. All right, so just want to share with you quickly, I know everyone here is familiar with and is connected to and or a friend of NCWIT, but we are really about, our mission is around broadening the influential and meaningful participation of women and girls in computing. And we do that through a three-pronged strategy in which we aim to convene, equip, and unite. The convening arm of the work that we do is through our annual summit and also through our five alliances that we have at NCWIT. We equip our members and other folks who are part of the tech community via the hundreds of online research-based resources that we have related to various aspects of broadening participation of women and girls in computing. And I'll be highlighting here toward the end of our conversation some important resources related to the tech workforce. And finally, we unite through a wide variety of programs that we have and initiatives, some of them including our Aspirations in Computing Initiative, Technola Chicas, and our Sit With Me campaign. So just a little bit about this series, if we could head to the next slide. So the Color of Our Future conversation series really was anchored around Black History Month in February and also March, which is Women's History Month. And we really wanted to have a deep conversation around important questions related to broadening the participation of Black women and girls in computing. And as we mentioned before, this is part of a three-part series. Our first conversation focused on the K-12 arena. The conversation that we had just 2 weeks ago was highlighting post-secondary education and the experiences that Black women had there. And today we will be talking about and exploring key issues and solutions to advancing and enhancing the experiences of Black women across the tech ecosystem. So, you know, why is this so important? I think all of us know this. Women in general are underrepresented in tech. Women of color are even more underrepresented. And when you think about Black women make up 3% of the computing workforce. And that's compared to women in general, who make up 26% of the computing workforce. And I was looking at an article about Black women in tech inclusion, and I wanted to pull just a quote, which I think really sums up why we're here today, from Shawnee Lee Christensen, who says, "It's hard to see yourself growing in a company when you don't see yourself represented." And I think that's very, very important, and exactly the reason why we're here today, to talk about the experiences of Black women in the tech workforce and ways in which we can work through solutions for ensuring that we move that needle beyond the 3%. Also, just wanted to let you know that today is not the end. So the Color of Our Future really launched this conversation series, but it's bigger than just Black women and girls in tech. We know and we understand that computing pathways really do bridge the gap economically, socially, politically, and culturally for women and girls of color now and on into the future. And so we have launched this Color of Our Future as an organizational strategy that will really anchor all of our programs, initiatives, and our resources that's aimed to focus, again, the meaningful and influential participation of all underrepresented women and girls of color in tech. And that includes Black, Latinx, and Native American women and girls, so that we can positively impact the future of computing. So at this time, I'd like to introduce our wonderful, wonderful panelists. First, we have Blessing Adegame. Blessing, if you are, I know you're here, if you could just raise your hand for the panelists to see you. There she is. Blessing is an undergraduate student working on her degree in computer information systems at Drexel University. In addition to that, I don't know how she imagines to have time to do all these things, but in addition to that, Blessing is the initiator of Students of LinkedIn. She is the chief vision officer for the Boundless brand, and she also serves as the co-founder of Blooming Lasting Careers. So welcome Blessing to our panel. And we're dying to know how much time off you have now that I'm sure that Drexel is either moving to or has already transitioned to the virtual space for the remaining portion of the semester. Now I'd like to introduce Dr. Andrea Bowens-Jones. Hello. Dr. Bowens-Jones is a former Procter & Gamble section head. And now she serves as a STEM diversity inclusion consultant, certified coach, trainer, and speaker. She is president and CEO of IDG Vision Consulting and Training, where she focuses on equipping leaders and their teams to be successful. Her current initiatives focus on women and STEM leaders. And Dr. Andrea also serves as a corporate initiatives consultant with us at NCWIT. Next up, we have Yvonne Melton. Hello, Yvonne. And I'm waving too. I shouldn't be waving. I don't know. I see you waving, so I'm waving back. So Yvonne is program manager on Google's computer science education team. In her role, she manages external partnerships and works with program teams such as CS First and Applied Digital Skills to increase access and exposure to computer science education and digital skills. And previously, Yvonne worked to engage talent for business roles at Google as a diversity industry program specialist and also a staffing specialist. So welcome, Yvonne. And finally, we have Avis Yates Rivers. There you are. Avis Yates Rivers serves as president and CEO of Technology Concepts Groups International. TCGI, which is a global asset expense and procurement management firm. She possesses more than 35 years of general management experience in the information technology industry, and she's been a successful tech entrepreneur for over 30 years. So welcome to our esteemed panel, and I'd like to toss it over now to Dr. Catherine Ashcraft, who is our Director of Research for NCWIT, and she will facilitate the remaining portion of our panel.
Great, thanks, Jeffrey Ann. Can you all hear me okay? So before we dive in, I also want to thank our incredible panelists for joining us and all of you on the call for joining this important conversation today. Very excited to be a part of it and hear all your thoughts on these topics. So let's go ahead and jump into question one. which we will have all of the panelists answer by way of introduction. And I believe this is a pretty talkative group, so feel free to please start off and turn take as you see fit. But as you can see here, our goal in this conversation series is to empower and celebrate the contributions of Black women and girls in computing. So let's begin by having each of you share with us some of the specific work that you're doing to hold space for and give voice to Black women in tech.
Okay, I'll go first. this is Dr. Andrea Bowens-Jones. Well, I've been passionate about this particular topic for quite some time. So I'll start with, there are three things that I'm doing. One, I started actually while I was at Procter & Gamble, and it was through the initiation of a program called the Resident Scholar Program that was focused on creating job shadow opportunities for minorities interested in careers in engineering. And this gave an opportunity for more, in particular girls, because that's what we actively recruited so that the numbers would reflect that one. So that's a program that has welcomed well over several hundred students. When I left Procter & Gamble, we were over 200, and now those students, many of them are professionals that I still mentor and keep up with on LinkedIn and things like that. And currently as a consultant, I work with NCWIT. So I have the opportunity to engage companies to shape their culture, to build a much more inclusive culture. So when those women do show up, they have the opportunity to be successful in it. And then the third one is through the work that I do through IDG Vision, my company, where I focus on equipping women. So many times I found that when you really speak about a voice, feeling like you are have a place at the table and feeling like you can make a meaningful contribution, a lot of times it starts with the mindset first, feeling like you belong in a place. And so quite a bit of the work that I do is, one, helping build personal awareness for women so that they that voice that they hear in their head, they have the courage to say it out loud. So I offer coaching. I have a virtual coaching club that I do that, as well as one-on-one coaching, and do some training and development in that space. A lot of fun stuff.
I'll go ahead and jump in next. Hi, everyone. My name is Yvonne Melton, and I work at Google as a computer science and digital skills education program manager. In my role, I primarily focus on partnerships with organizations, professional organizations like the American Association of School Librarians, or CSTA, the Computer Science Teachers Association. So a lot of my work is primarily focused on ensuring that teachers in diverse communities and Black teachers are able to have opportunities to attend and participate in these professional level organizations so that they can have access to the resources and the education and tools that they need to take it back to their students. And so I think a lot of the work that I do includes sometimes whether it's providing travel funding to attend and participate in these organizations, to providing funding through donorschoose.org, and a number of different things, and also working with NCWIT, but primarily focused on supporting people that are already in communities to ensure that the next generation of students has and is able to have access to computer science education at the K-12 level.
Next. So my name is Blessing. I am currently a junior at Drexel studying information systems. Right now, I'm actually at Bloomberg interning as a data engineer. So in my sophomore year, I launched a cohort program that focused on retention of women in technical majors. I realized that the problem wasn't necessarily recruiting more female students to study computer science or any sort of technical related major, but the problem was retaining them, because I noticed that after their freshman year, students would just disperse and go into different majors. So I wanted to tackle that problem, especially when it comes to diversity within Drexel, within the College of Computing and Informatics. So I launched that program, and basically what the cohort aims to do is just educate students about the different opportunities that there are when it comes to technology. And one of the things that kind of scared me away from computer science in my freshman year was I didn't think that I was talented enough or skilled enough to be in that major. And that's why I switched my major to information systems. But I wanted to create a small community of people that could share their stories as well as their passions, and so that we can realize that despite like our differences and our different interests, technology can fit into each one of those things. So that was my initiative for that. And with Boundless Brand, this is kind of like a collection of initiatives that teaches students how to think and create beyond the default path. So whether it's college or corporate, one of the things I did recently for my birthday was launch a scholarship program where I was able to raise $2,500 for international students, in which four of them were Black women in STEM majors. So that was just my way as a student to give back to other students and to show them that just because you're a student, just because you have that title, it does not restrict you from achieving different things.
Thanks. It's quite a birthday project.
Well, how awesome was all of that? Congratulations, ladies. I am honored to be included in this number with you all on the panel today. I am Avis Yvonne Yates Rivers, my middle name, so I thought I'd get that out there, Yvonne. Yvonne. And I am the founder and CEO of Technology Concepts Group International, based in Somerset, New Jersey. And so being a tech entrepreneur for 36 years, yeah, I don't believe I said that either, but it is true. You know, I have had the great fortune and honor of hiring interns and permanent employees and serving as a mentor and a role model to many young women who look like me across the years. I don't even know how to begin to count them. And I still serve as a mentor to many who are in the tech field, who are Black women and beyond that demographic. But since that's who we're talking about today, definitely want to spotlight that. I learned over 15 years ago about the declining participation of women in technology when I got introduced to Lucy Sanders, the CEO and co-founder of NCWIT, who came all the way to New Jersey to encourage me to join the board of directors. And it wasn't something I was looking to do, but once I understood the dilemma and the problem, then how could I not? I didn't realize that as a tech founder and being out here on my own for 36 years was such a unicorn, but because I didn't have time to pay attention to that, right? But the more I got immersed in NCWIT as a board member and an executive board member and chair of the development committee, you know, it became very important to me to make sure that little girls who look like me from the Bronx, you know that they are smart enough and that they are good enough to be in technology. Just what Blessing shared with us. There's many Blessings out there. Avis was out there not so long ago, you know, as one of those young girls who did not have access or exposure to the opportunities that present themselves a little more so now. And so not only did I join the board, but I became the organization's national spokesperson. And so I have the honor of traveling around the country and participating in events and as a keynote speaker and panelist for many organizations who are trying to broaden the conversation. And I took it one step further and I became a published author in 2017. My first book is entitled Necessary Inclusion, Embracing the Changing Faces of Technology. Again, my effort to broaden the conversation and get folks beyond just the NCWIT community engaged in this very important mission of ours. And so, you know, it just now is my total passion and purpose in life is to make sure that our girls get every opportunity to thrive in this industry.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thanks, everyone. And it's so great to hear about that impressive array of important work that you're all doing. I also think it nicely kind of demonstrates the need for a range of complementary programs that both support individual women and also focus on, as Andrea said, changing the workplace culture, and having that kind of complementary mix is really well represented here. And as Blessing said, to focus on not just recruiting, but also retention and changing the culture as well. So, Johnny is our second question up there. So here's our second question. We know that Black women do not represent a critical mass in the technical workforce. As you can see here in 2017, Black women made up only 3% of the computing workforce. So let's talk a little bit about the barriers and areas of opportunity here. So first, what are some of the barriers that keep participation so low? And what are some strategies that you've seen or are needed to achieve a critical mass of Black women working and, importantly, also thriving in computing?
Now, Catherine, are you going to call on us or are you just wanting us to jump in here?
I think you can jump in, but I will be happy to call on if if there's a lull. But go ahead, Avis.
Well, one of the barriers that is very prevalent out there today is we don't see enough of ourselves represented. And so as Black women, we will typically not try to engage in that kind of a setting where we don't see ourselves represented. That is very, very critical. But the reason why many of us are not represented is because we don't look like technologists, right? Sometimes I kid and say, I'm not a technologist, I just play one on TV. But that is not that's not the truth. You know, while I don't have a PhD in computer science, I think 36 years of being in the tech industry gives me that stamp of approval as a technologist. And, you know, there's so much by the way of image that prevents us from really participating at the fullest level, right? We don't look the part. We typically don't have the background, education or otherwise. We typically don't have the financial backing, you know, to do the things that we could do in a more fuller fashion had we had that. You know, I often think about the dot-com boom and then bust. Right, how much money flowed through hands at that period, but not through any of the hands that look like mine, right? Who had established business, customers, employees, track record, not just an idea on the back of a napkin. And so not having access to those halls of where money is decided to be parlayed out, right? Not looking the part, not being taken seriously, you know, are some of the barriers that I've experienced in technology.
Yeah. And I'll sort of jump in just on some of the things that Avis was saying around lack of access. And I don't know, a lot of you may or may not know, a few years ago, Google produced a couple of research reports around the state of computer science in the US. And, you know, one of them was Women Who Choose CS. We know that encouragement, career perception, self-perception, and academic exposure, some of the same things that Avis just mentioned as some of her personal experiences in those studies, we found to be actually like true in terms of factors that of why women were choosing CS. And then even more so, we also did a report around diversity gaps in the computer science education space. And we know that Black students are more likely to be interested in CS, but sometimes, and a lot of times, they don't have as much access to learn CS. And so in my role, we're really primarily focused on that gap of how do we work on increasing that access to education so that when students or girls are going to college, they're choosing to major in CS. And then if they go into industry, they have had these experiences prior to when they get to those spaces.
Yeah, I love that you brought up that piece because it takes it back to the pipeline, because even before they can choose to go in it, they have to have had some kind of exposure early on. Just like this series started off with K-12 and then went through the university piece. One of the things that I saw, like in engaging students going out to middle schools and going out to high schools, is when I would show up and I'm representing a technology interest or just to talk about it, the number of girls that just would come just to learn was always low. You're basically begging them to come in. So I think a lot of it is before they can aspire to do something or to be something, there are no examples on TV that show them that they can be that. There are no examples in their families that shows them that it's possible, because it's somebody I know personally that has done it. And so when you even get to the school and making the choice, not having had exposure or even awareness of the opportunity that's there, to me, is still a barrier for students to even enter into the field. So yes, I agree with that 100%.
Yeah, I also agree with that as well. I think for me growing up, I would say I was always interested in technology. I just didn't know how I would get there. I came from the UK to study at Drexel, and that's kind of why I chose computer science. Well, I had no family member who was in the technical industry, and obviously coming from Scotland, I did not see anyone that looked like me in a position that I hoped to be in one day. So it wasn't until I came to Drexel and I saw one black female student who was a software engineering major. And that's actually why I switched my major to that after computer science. And I was like, no, this still isn't for me. It's one thing to see someone in your position, but then also try and find like your own way to success, I guess. Yeah. So I saw another black female student who was an information systems major. She was more interested in cybersecurity. So I was able to talk to her, and from there I switched my major to information systems. But I think representation is definitely an important thing. I have entered in a lot of different companies who have claimed to have a diversity and inclusion, you know, some sort of effort or program or anything like that. And once I would enter the company, I would ask like, okay, where is everything happening? Because I see it on like a external level, but inside there's nothing there. There's no support for me as a college student that would make me want to come back for full time. So I think it definitely is a pipeline problem, and it definitely starts from as low as when you're in middle school, but definitely as well college, because that's when people really decide what industry they want to go into.
Yeah, and I'm wondering also, a few of you have mentioned this fact of not looking like a person in tech or not seeing people who look like you. And just kind of building on that, I'm wondering to what extent you all think that things like everyday biases, like micro inequities or microaggressions or personality penalties, kind of play a role in the barriers women face. Just because I know when we work with companies a lot in the tech industry, that's something that comes up quite a bit, is just those everyday biases that kind of subtly chip away at a sense of belonging. So just curious if any of you have thoughts on the extent to which that's a barrier, and, or your experiences with that.
Oh yeah, I would say I would agree with that. Just the thought of being a woman in science, and I can speak from a STEM because I'm actually a PhD polymer chemist by training. So I represent the S today versus the T, but the feeling that when you're the only one, it is hard to blend in, to not stand, to intentionally not stand out. So working twice as hard, or feeling like you have to work twice as hard, or the expectation that this woman is going to show up, I'm going to have to give her some special treatment in order for her to be successful or feel supported. So I think that plays a huge role in the ability for the individuals to feel like they can be successful in a particular area because of that.
You're absolutely right, Andrea. And when it comes to within these organizations, Blessing really nailed the hammer to the nail on the head when she said she heard about the externally facing interest in diversity and inclusion, but when she got there, she mm-hmm. saw nor felt any indication that it actually existed. And I think women in tech organizations today feel that same way. While there's an ERG for this and an initiative for that, where is the real support coming from? Where is the real mentoring and sponsorship coming from? Who's making decisions about me and the rest of my career here when I'm not even in the room? And what kind of formalized structure does that take, right? And so, Catherine, I know you asked a leading question because I know the work that you all do around micro inequities and stereotype threats. Yeah, but it's easy to be overlooked in the room. And so what do? We sit back and we're quiet. And unless someone intentionally engages those quiet voices or really supports the comments that are made that are glossed over by women and supported when they're made by men, you know, those are all intentional things that has to happen. And if an organization is not culturally intentional and doing those things, women and Black women will continue to feel just, you know, out there on their own.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think that's a great segue to the second part of this question, where we were looking at what are some of the strategies that companies can put in place, particularly to change the culture of their actual workplace for people, women that are already in these occupations or once they enter these occupations. Strategies that you've seen be successful or strategies you'd like to see implemented.
Really organized mentoring programs is one in advocacy, because I think a lot of times what's lacking is real advocacy for women to be, whether it be supported and advanced in the workplace. And I know that's a later question as well, but I think those kind of companies that get it have a strong support system in place. When I look back on my career at P&G, one of the things that was a huge positive is that day one, I had a buddy when I entered into the company. And that person had a background that was fairly similar to mine. So I could have a safe place to kind of ask questions and kind of learn and not feel like you're stupid in front of meetings, because you need that when you're new. But also as my career grew, then having them guide me on the kind of mentors, not just someone that looks like me, but the kind of mentors that are in rooms that I wasn't in, so they could be advocates for me. So strong programs like that, that are very organized, to me helps with that one. And of course, getting on some of the points that you made earlier, Catherine, about just the awareness with everyday bias, which takes training for organizations to understand how to shift their culture from some of the traditional ways to then have different practices.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that evolves a lot of what Avis was saying too about interrupting everyday bias in terms of being intentional and noticing like who's being heard in meetings and making sure that becomes a norm of hearing quieter voices and people who are interrupted.
Yeah. And Catherine, I also think it's important, and I'm not sure we're there yet, but I think it's important for companies or large tech organizations to be specific in their quest to support Black women, mm-hmm. right? As opposed to women, a women's initiative, because as you know, leading our social science group, that there are challenges for all women, but then there are different challenges mm-hmm. for different women. And we cannot all be clumped into the same bucket and feel like they are addressing all of our needs. So I think companies who are looking to become more intentional and best in class really need to start focusing on the intersectionality of women, and race is a key one of those.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's such a great point. And that I think also involves like disaggregating data by race and gender rather than just race or gender, and paying attention to which women are benefiting from the different kinds of programs.
Yes.
So in the interest of time, yes, let's move to question three. Thanks, Johnny. So you can see here, we want to talk about a move to talking about leadership in organizations and in industry. So let's talk about how the representations of Black women in tech leadership roles play out, and what can we do to increase the numbers of Black women at this level?
Sponsorship. They need sponsors at the high levels. In the C-suite, people who are really sponsoring, seeing the change and model it and being courageous enough to create more room at the table. I was talking to a client of mine who was kind of just discussing some of her pains with advancement. And one of the responses that she got from another person that was already at a level that she was aspiring, she said, "So do I have to give up my seat so you can have one?" And I think getting people to understand it's not about me giving up my seat, but me creating room for you to have a seat at the table. So strong sponsorship. So if this was a game show, that's what I'd put 100 on, strong sponsorship.
Any other takers for?
Well, since we, know, we know that white males are still in the great majority of folks in leadership and IT organizations. I think our work, your work, Catherine Wendy, on what makes a man become a strong ally for women, all women, but in particular, Black women. How can we identify and find those men and then continue to replicate them? I'd like to see that continue longitudinally, like we've done with some of the other studies, not just a one-time study, but men are still making 90%+ of the decisions, sitting in 90%+ of those seats. How do they feel about Black women not having a role in leadership at in their organizations, and then helping them to understand some of the things that they can do about it? So I'd like to go to the source and target those individuals. Sponsorships, as Andrea said, is key, but they probably don't even know us.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So there's a gap that needs to be bridged there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Awareness first, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think it's true that some people don't even realize they're sponsoring, right? Like sponsoring happens so informally that that's one of the things we try to do is get people to be more intentional about and pay attention to who they're sponsoring. Are they just sponsoring people that look like them? To your point, Eva, they don't even know maybe that there are other people they should be sponsoring. Mm-hmm. And we've started broadening that conversation around male allies too, to include just majority group allies in general, and kind of the way allyship shifts and trying to enlist more majority group allies, to your point.
And we know that there's also some backlash that's coming from white men. I mean, I've been personally privy to it when I keynoted the North Dakota annual cybersecurity conference last year, the year before last. And one of the questions from the audience of mostly white men was, so that means I should not even try for that new job, right? I shouldn't even apply. I shouldn't, as if he was taking it personally that I was promoting women to be more of us to be more inclusive of women. He was taking it personally that that meant that he no longer had any opportunity. So we have to be able to address that and message around that effectively as well.
Mm-hmm. Right. Any last comments panelists want to add before we move to question four? All right. How can the tech industry leverage membership resources from professional organizations to bridge the gap of women for women in color in tech? And what's the balance of where industry going to professional organizations should be happening versus organizations coming to industry?
Well, I can speak to some of the work that I do with partnerships. I work with a lot of professional organizations specifically for educators. And I think for us, the balance really varies in terms of who comes to us versus us going to them. But I do think that we are very intentional about seeking out organizations that have a large reach, and then also helping those organizations to make sure that they are bringing in people who wouldn't normally seek out membership in those organizations. The first thing that comes to mind for me is CSTA. We've been doing a lot of work with CSTA for a while, but more recently also ensuring and sharing out the fact that this professional membership organization actually exists for teachers that are interested in computers and are teaching computer science, which I think that a lot of teachers in, you know, low-income areas or diverse communities may not necessarily know about. So I think that's one example of one of the ways that I've been able to work directly with a professional level organization to sort of expand and reach and reach out to the community as well.
Great, thanks. Are there other thoughts on the role of professional organizations or the relationship between industry and professional organizations or things that you've seen be effective?
I've done some interacting with the BDPA, the Black Data Processing Association, and they're a national organization with regional and local chapters all over the country. And my outside looking in perspective is that while they're trying to grow and do a good work, I think industry always sees them and other like organizations as someone coming for handouts or funding or sponsorship to conferences. And I think we need to elevate that thinking, right? This organization, particularly, I've watched them for the last 20 some odd years and how they have matured and grown, but they're still having to beg for, you know, for sponsorship, for credibility, because they don't have the financial backing as some of the other larger general population ones. So I think that as an organization or a company, that we need to take a closer look at organizations like that, that cater to this specific demographic, and see how we can engage with them and be supportive of them and not just attend their national conference or things of that sort.
So industry needs to take a more active role.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think that that's a good ending point for some of these questions here. In the interest of time, we want to leave time for your questions as well. So I'm going to hand it back to, I think, Jeffrianne to facilitate some Q&A with the panel. I think you're on mute, Jeffrianne.
I thought I hit unmute, but maybe not. This has been such a great conversation. I know that I wanted to just take a moment before we jump into our Q&A. We've had so many wonderful questions and comments happening in the chat. Just to highlight a few of our resources that we have available that really are connected to this conversation. So Johnny, if you could just for a moment go back to our NCWIT resource slide. So we have a number of resources here. I will say that all of our resources attend to and are intentional related to intersectionality. So we do have resources that speak to, broadening and looking at the experiences of women and girls of color. And then we have other resources that are more attentive towards that as well. So just wanted to let you know about some of the wonderful resources that we have available. And then now, I think we can start by maybe addressing a couple of the questions. Well, no, we'll start here. If there are any folks who are attendees who'd like to ask our panelists or to raise any questions or have comments, please feel free to do that now. And or I can call some of you folks out who I know wrote comments in the chat. Well, Valerie, I'm going to call you out because I saw your comment in the chat, and I think it's a really great question. So if you're on, would you mind? You're still on. I'm going to unmute myself and ask you to share your question.
Sure. Hi, Avis. I really enjoyed your comments, and in particular, when you talked about the backlash from men in particular. I wanted to ask, what sort of strategies can you think of that would prevent the zero-sum thinking that often comes around these discussions of inclusiveness? You know, the fact that, you know, people think if you win, I lose. And, you know, how do you combat that? Because I think that is unfortunately very common in a lot of people's thinking.
You're right, Valerie. And I think certainly Catherine and Wendy are in a better position to validate this. But I do know that from their research over the years that they are advocating for organizations to change their culture and their processes and their thinking because it would benefit everybody. Not just women, but it would benefit women of all kinds, and it would benefit men as well. So if your culture is more inclusive and listening and valuing everyone's contribution, that's also going to value men's contribution as well. So I think it's about making sure that we messaged that way, that yes, we are focusing on women and Black women in this case because of their very low participation. But it's because that these tech organizations have been built years and years ago by white men for white men, that we're now trying to help you adjust it so that it will be more welcoming to others and better for everybody who gets in there together. So I think it's all around how we message and show the results of the research that is being done. Mm-hmm. Catherine, you want to add to that? Or Wendy?
No, I think that was a great description, Avis. And I think also just kind of making clear that part of the reason, our rationales for doing this, right, work is, you know, making sure that we hear all of the ideas and improving innovation and pointing out that, you know, it's not a competition. It's about, you know, getting those ideas out and not leaving them on the table, right? That so many perspectives are not being heard right now. And so we're missing out on all kinds of ideas that could be producing better technologies.
I see that we have Quincy Brown on our call, and I just wanted to, I hate to put you on the spot, Quincy, but I wanted to have you, because we had a comment or two about conferences in the chat, and I'm wondering, Quincy, if you wouldn't mind just sharing more about Black Compute Her. And I know the conference has been postponed because of coronavirus, but I think our attendees would benefit from hearing more about Black Compute Her as an organization, if you wouldn't mind.
That for me, Quincy? Sorry. Hello?
Yes, that was for Quincy.
Oh, okay, sorry. I stepped away for a hot second, but I couldn't tell if you guys could hear me.
Oh, okay. So I'm sorry to put you on the spot. I saw that you were on the call and thought that given there were questions related to conferences that were happening in the chat, if you wouldn't mind just for a minute sharing with the group about Black Compute Her.
Sure, sure. So Black Computer is an organization, blackcomputer.org, that hosts an annual conference. It was supposed to be April 2 through 4, so we're typically the first weekend in April in DC. And it was designed by myself and Dr. Chiquita Thomas and Dr. Jamika Burge, who are all Black women, PhDs in computer science. Here, I'll turn my camera on since I'm speaking. Who are all PhDs in computer science. And it was really born out of our experiences of being in the space as students and as faculty, and also as professionals in the workforce and industry, thinking about all of the times we went to conferences or different gatherings and really didn't feel that our needs or our issues were addressed as Black women. So in ones that were focused on diversity, we didn't really feel like we had a space. In ones that were focused on gender, we also didn't feel like we had a space. And what we would end up doing was hanging out in someone's room afterwards, you know, eating cake and drinking or whatever. But we started to have what we called the conference after the conference. And over, you know, over some amount of time, we just, you know, we kind of thought to ourselves, you know, it was like, well, this should be the conference, right? And so the conference was born out of that. Avis has spoken. I've seen many familiar names and faces in here, but really it's about having a gathering and a conference for us. It's not about us. And so we talk about the things and the topics that really matter to us, that we know aid in our persistence and our resilience, the things that make us laugh and cry. We also talk technical topics because a lot of what you find in literature about strategies and, you know, approaches in the DEI space don't always work for us for a myriad of reasons. And so we have those conversations. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate you sharing. Someone asked about having access to this recording, and we will be publishing on our website within the next few weeks. The recording and all the recordings for this conversation series, so please stay tuned. And I think Wanda Scott, did you have a question? Okay.
I did. Hi, I'm so grateful for these conversations, and I was waiting for this particular conference call to happen. I posted a question, but then it was very shortly addressed once we move forward in the question. So I'm thankful about that. My question is to the panel in general. I know Avis is has her own business, but there is a huge, I was a network engineer for about 15 years, and then I was an IT college professor. And I didn't leave the industry because I felt like I couldn't progress. I felt like I could. But I know that I've mentored and talked to so many women who reach a level of success, but can't go from mid-level to executive level or to even middle management. And I guess the question out there is, I see that Avis has achieved success as CEO with her own company, but I just don't see Black women going past, you know, having being a successful engineer, being a successful programmer to the higher ranks. And I think that's just something that doesn't get talked about enough, moving from mid-level to executive level and the supports there for women to progress in those corporate positions.
Yeah, so I wonder, particularly if Avis or Andrea, if you have thoughts about that, having been in industry.
I just unmuted my mic, Catherine, but then I hesitated because I feel like I've been doing too much talking. I wanted to give others an opportunity to jump in there. You know, as a keynote, we just the only ones talking. So, but Wanda, thank you so much for that observation. And you're absolutely right. In fact, it is at the mid-career level where many women leave the leave their tech workforce or their tech career, as has been borne out by research. And I think it's so complex, the reason why Black women are not elevating to positions of leadership, especially in the larger organizations, is because, number one, they're not in the pipeline, they're not known. And what I find is that people are coming to those CIO, CTO positions from a whole host of different types of pathways, right? Not just as an engineer or a programmer. And so unless there are particular intentional steps being taken by senior leadership to advance his women and his, oh, listen to me, her women and her Black women into more senior positions, then it's just not going to happen, because we know that task assignments are pretty much flawed in the way that they are given out. And women, we know this from research, are not going to overwhelmingly jump at new stretch opportunities if they don't feel like they measure up to all the requirements associated with it. And so we have to, I think that there has to be very specific internal, when I was back in corporate America, there was a management track, or what they called a fast track. Every 18 to 24 months, I was in a different position. That was a few years ago. But I don't know, I don't hear about that being done similarly today, where they recognize talent. Nobody cared that I was from New York City public school system, right? They recognize talent. And so that's the kind of recognition and structure that I think will get more women past that barrier of middle management into the senior ranks. In all of my years being in the tech industry, I have only known one Black female CIO of a global multinational Fortune 5 corporation. Just one. just one.
Yeah, it's interesting. This is Elizabeth. Hello, Avis. It's great to see you again.
Hi, Elizabeth.
I am now at Avanade, and I would say we are very fortunate to have a Black woman as our CEO. That was effective as of this past September. And what I observed is that it was very deliberate sponsorship, you know, on the part of our prior CEO, and really setting this individual up for success. So I wholly agree with the sponsorship and the focus there. I guess the question that I had, I remember when I was more involved with NCWIT back when I was at RBC, there was a great focus on what male managers can do, kind of the top 10 tips. Has NCWIT done a double click on, you know, what are the top 10 tips specifically as it applies to women of color? And if not, how could we partner to get that done?
Catherine, that sounds like something for you.
Am I off mute? Yes. Yeah, that's a great question. I think we have done some things in other resources, like our majority group ally resource that touch on that topic. I think that particular resource you're referencing could definitely be updated to focus on a broader range of things that people can do to help support women of color in that space. But I think there's some other complementary resources like the Majority Group Ally Toolkit and also our intersectionality resource and the colorism resource that Jeffrey Ann had highlighted in the resource list of links. But yeah, we can talk more about that offline as well.
And can I add that there's got to be a desire for these mid-level women, Black women, to want to move forward, because as it's already been discussed, they don't feel supported in the space that they're already in. Mm-hmm. And so everything that you all have been talking about as far as sponsorship and, you know, the intersectionality is very important, so that when they are approached and those positions are advertised, that they not only can be have an advocate and be championed, but they feel like they can move to positions and apply for positions like that and be supported. Because there are women who have made it to those positions, but they've been so ostracized, they have not stayed. So that's another conversation in itself as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think a lot of times when it gets to those high level positions, because people tend, and I don't know the right word for it, to pick people they're familiar with, they're comfortable with, because the trust is already there. And if those Black women haven't broken through that barrier to build those kind of relationships, even if they have the talent, a lot of times their names won't be picked on the list, because it goes back to something you said, Avis, about those strategic positions. It's like a chess game. They are aligned well in advance, 2 or 3 moves in their career, in order to get those people in a position to have had the right kind of experiences to be vetted for those senior level positions.
Yeah, and that's how can we get our women positioned to even be in the game, to be on the board?
Yeah. Right?
Because if we're not in the game and we're not on the board, no matter what else is going on, we're not going to reach those key positions because they're so strategically done.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I remember when Ursula Burns was handpicked by the female CEO of Xerox that preceded her and intentionally groomed to become CEO of Xerox, the first Black female CEO mm-hmm. of a tech firm. That took years of grooming yeah. and selection and intention on the part of the sitting CEO. And that's just not happening, you know, every day, any day that we're aware of. That was like a 1 in a million kind of thing, but it should become more of the norm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I read a book years ago, Empowering Yourself, where it talked about the PI model. I don't know if people are familiar with that one. But to me, that particular book, and I'm sorry, I can't remember the author's, Harvey Coleman, I think was his name, where he talked about it takes more than just performance to be advanced. It takes the image and the exposure. And I think that's the thing that we underestimate is you can be really, really good, but if you don't have the right relationships and the right image and exposed to the right people, you will not be on somebody's short list.
Right, and we have to take leadership, we have to take ownership of our career. Right? We have to be the ones making strategic moves as well, and not just sit and wait for others to do it for us. So, you know, I think it was Wanda who mentioned that if we're not supported at the current level, how will we be supported if we go even higher in the organization? Yeah, I think that, and that's something that stuck with me. And I don't know, maybe it's because I was born in New York City, but you know, it's just about that. Just get it, just go for it. Just get it done. Just don't stop. Just don't be stopped. And you know, that's easier said clearly than done, but it's just a mindset that I think we would be well served to adopt.
And I think the other thing this points to is the need for also examining biases, subtle biases in like performance evaluation criteria and the criteria we use to select like leadership development, you know, or high potential folks like you were talking about, Avis. It's about being intentional about that and paying attention to who's being selected for those kinds of programs and development and looking for biases in those selection processes as well.
Well, it is 4:05, if you can believe it or not. Time certainly flies when you're having fun. So I think at this point we will, I guess we have unofficially ended, but if folks are still interested in staying on for just a few more minutes until about maybe 4:10, I see that Sandy Keeter has placed a really great question in the chat. Sandy, would you mind posing your question to the larger group?
I'm wondering if it was me or if it was my colleague Arlene.
Yes, it's me.
Oh, okay. She signed in.
Okay.
She
okay.
I didn't post anything.
Sorry. Give me 1 second. Okay. Hi. My name is Arlene Gonzalez. Actually, we joined in on the same link because I didn't get to register in time. So my question is, we work here at Sunwell State College. Myself, Sandra Keeter, and Dr. Robinson are working on a strategic plan. Well, we built a strategic plan through NCWIT to help increase our women in our tech programs, the diversity in women of color. So we have some things that we've put together, but I was just looking to get some feedback from you all. We had prior created a club, a student-led club for our women in IT. And it started off as a really great idea, but we really haven't had much engagement. And part of the challenge is that our students, we have a lot of non-traditional students, and they are balancing work, school, families, and studying here, mostly part-time, technology and computer science tracks. How would you recommend that we can engage these students so we can provide that mentorship and that support for them to retain them and increase their access to industry and opportunities?
This sounds like a great question for Blessing.
Sure, I can try and answer this. So one of the reasons why, so I started a cohort program when I was in my sophomore year. In my freshman year, I came in as a computer science major, and it was myself and my other two friends who also came in as computer science majors who we collectively decided to create another program. There was already an existing Women in Computing Science or Women in Computing Society, an existing club that was there for female students in technology, but we realized that it wasn't giving us what we needed. It was kind of this situation where on an external facing kind of perspective, everything looks great. You know, they're bringing on more students, engaging more students, but when you're actually inside the club, you don't feel welcomed. The content isn't tailored towards your specific needs. So one of the reasons why we created our own program was so that we could attack those pain points. So not just having a generic mentorship program, but tailoring that so that we meet the students where they are. If they come from a background of, let's say, if they like finance or they like fashion, we tell them, okay, this is what your background is or this is what you're interested in. How can we now help you to integrate technology with that, whether it's building an app or exposing you to different industries or to different companies that have those positions that you might be interested in. That was definitely something that I felt like I needed with a mentorship program as a college sophomore, junior in computing science or in any technical major. And that's why I wanted to create that program so that I could kind of be that change that I wish to see in the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we do have a lot of ideas to really customize that and get more in depth. We're just having a problem just getting them, bringing them in and getting them engaged because of the lack of time and resources that they have. Like financially, they don't have the resources, so they're relying on balancing work and school. And so really the challenge for them is to find that extra time outside of taking their classes to come and participate in something else, you know? And so I think it's hard for them to really understand the value yet because they haven't had that experience and exposure as to how it's so important and valuable for them, especially in this experience for them. So, but that very, very insightful, I agree with you.
I think your issue is not uncommon. I worked with a local program here with some of the community schools, the two-year programs, and because the students are single moms and they're balancing childcare and all this. But one of the things that I've seen worked well for one program is having the companies come, because if they could link it to a job, it seemed more tangible, and that's a way to get the professional development in there, but you're doing it through the sponsoring companies. And whether it's linked through a paid internship or exposure that will lead to a job, it was like dangling a carrot.
Right.
And they were able to increase their attendance with it. So just an idea.
That's helpful.
And if I can throw out there, I worked at Nashville State Community College, which had a very similar non-traditional and working women. And we did that. We partnered with a local chapter of WIT. And what we did was we ended up being able to get them an internship, which paid, so they wouldn't feel like they'd have to leave their full-time job. And we had a scholarship. So once the word got out, just like Andrea was saying, that there was opportunities coming with paid work and scholarships, they started attending to find out more about how they could be involved and get, you know, take advantage of those things.
Thank you. That's helpful.
Okay. Are there any final questions and or comments before we adjourn?
Jeffrey, I just wanted to thank you all again for inviting me. I have pushed back my call twice now, but I better jump. But it was certainly my pleasure, and congratulations to all of the wonderful panelists and all that they're accomplishing, and of course, all of you at NCWIT. And thank you all who have joined the call today. And please continue. It's just I had another appointment that I'm now late for. So I'll talk to you all soon.
Okay. Thanks, Avis.
Bye-bye.
And before we officially adjourn or unofficially adjourn, looks like everyone's gone. Oh, no. Okay. All right. So thank you, Johnny. I got a little nervous that everyone had jumped off. We are hosting a Twitter chat in 2 weeks on Tuesday, March 24th on Black Women in Post-Secondary Computing Education. And this Twitter chat is in partnership with the Modern Figures Podcast and the Institute for African American Mentoring and Computer Science. So please stay tuned. And be on the lookout for promotional activity related to that. We would love for you all to join us. So, you know, on behalf of NCWIT, thank you all so much for joining us in today's conversation. Thank you again to our panelists. I'm actually kind of sad that we're closing out this conversation series, but as I mentioned at the top of the hour, right, for now, we're pausing for now. We will come back. We will be hosting other conversations related to other underrepresented women and girls of color in the very near future. So thank you all so much for joining us and have a fantastic afternoon.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.